Okay, I see people are starting to join us, and we are welcoming folks into the webinar. Welcome. Thank you for joining us here today. We're really glad to have you. We are just going to start off with a few poll questions before we get into the main content. So, as people are able to sort of filter in and join us. So, Michaela, do you want to launch that first poll question for us? Great. So we want to get a sense of kind of who's in the room, who's joining us here today. So if you want to just indicate where you are joining us from. Great. Looks like we've got most people who've responded so far. So might close that poll question, Michaela. We got a lot of public sector folks, mostly from cities. We got some county folks. We also have some consultants joining us today. So we're really glad that you could also join us, as well as folks from some other government agencies. So thanks for joining us here today. Michaela, do you want to launch the second question? Great. So we thought for transportation, it'd be good to sort of ask a transportation-related question of how you got to work today. So transit, drove, carpooled, walked a bike, or the classic work from home. Okay, it looks like we're kind of getting nearly everyone in there. So yeah, do you want to launch that one? Okay, it looks like we've got most people working from home. We got some folks who drove or carpooled today, but yeah, I've got a lot of work from home people here today. Michaela, you want to launch that last poll question here? Great. So we want to just get a sense of kind of how people are feeling. We've got a lot happening with these comp plan updates. So if you want to just give us a kind of a temperature read on kind of where you're feeling these days with the update process. Great. Okay, looks like we've got most everyone who's filled that one in. So, Michaela, do you want to launch the results there? Okay, looks like we've got a variety of feelings, some excitement, some nervousness, people feeling a little bit overwhelmed. So that's all fair. And so I want to make sure that we are able to kind of help folks get to where they want to be with these sessions and also just with our resources in general. So, okay, we can stop polls and just get us started, I think. So yeah, we are here to talk about transportation. We have been doing this series, Passport 2044, throughout the fall here. We've got a number of events coming up. So we talked about climate and economic development already, and we will have a number of events, especially in October and November, coming up. So if you are interested, we've got registration open and available on our website. We will also have a few more events to be scheduled in 2023. So in terms of our program today, I'm going to talk a bit about PSRC's plan review requirements, talk a bit about the Growth Management Act. We're also going to hear from PSRC transportation staff and talking about just some of the regional policy direction and Vision 2050 and our regional transportation plans. We're also going to have kind of a deep dive in talking specifically about planning for projects, all the various things to think about as part of your transportation plan update. Also, be hearing from WashDOT staff. So we're glad to have them join us today. We'll also be talking a little bit about planning for transit, and we'll also be joined by staff from Community Transit. So we will have opportunities for Q&A, which I think some of you are probably familiar with is from previous webinars. But just from some of the logistics here today, so we are recording the session. Presentations will be posted on our website. So if you want to refer back to them or want to share them with other colleagues, those will be available on our website soon. If you do have questions, please feel free to put them into the Q&A. And at the conclusion of the webinar today, there'll be a Title VI poll that we'll launch. So that is optional, but we do appreciate if you could fill that out and help us with our Title VI requirements. So the objective with today's session and with all the Passport to 2044 sessions is really to help provide resources to help you create local plans that can help advance our regional goals around mobility, climate, affordability, equity, all the cross-cutting themes in Vision 2050. So Vision 2050 has a lot of themes that kind of are woven throughout the plan. We're really focused here today on talking about some of the transportation planning requirements, but some of the big cross-cutting themes about providing opportunity, equity, affordability, climate, all intersect with work on transportation. So the whole of the plan, I think, is important for kind of understanding what we're hoping to get out of plan updates. So we have a plan review manual that provides resources about PSRC's plan review and certification process that was published last year. We had a webinar that was hosted last year if you want to refer back to that. But the manual is a really great resource of kind of all of our background information on our process and includes these checklists that help translate Vision 2050 to the local planning context. So we have these consistency tools for different types of plans, including the comprehensive plan. And the consistency tools really try to highlight some of the areas that are new in Vision 2050 or have changed in state law, and some of the things, some of the relevant resources to help support comprehensive plan updates. This is the tool that we use to help review comp plans. So we think this is a really great resource for jurisdictions to use in scoping plan updates and developing drafts along the way. So we are always happy to answer any questions that you might have about kind of what we're looking for in local plan updates. Our certification focus areas really center on transportation planning requirements and transportation related provisions in comp plans. So those are related to the Growth Management Act. There are also items about consistency with our regional transportation plan and consistency with Vision 2050 and the multi-county planning policies. I'm going to talk a little bit about the GMA related requirements today, but we'll also hear more about some of the regional policy objectives and vision and our regional transportation plan. So in terms of the GMA requirements for transportation planning, there haven't been any changes to the actual state requirements since our 2015-2016 update. So that's a helpful, clear place to start in terms of some of the work that you may want to do in terms of this plan update. But there have been some changes in terms of regional policy that we'll try to highlight and that you should just be aware of. There have been some minor updates to the Washington Administrative Code that provides some additional guidance around transportation issues, including things like more detail about the bicycle pedestrian components. So that might just be something to look out for. But as part of the GMA requirements for transportation, there are a lot of technical components, components related to analysis that you should be aware of and provide a lot of opportunity to do some deep digging on transportation. We're really going to focus later on in terms of work on project lists and financing. So that's going to be some of our focus today, but just a bit of context about some of the rest of the plan update. In terms of some of the existing helpful resources, Commerce published a transportation element guide back in 2012 that we think is still really useful, provides a really good overview of the basics of transportation elements and is available on Commerce's website. MRSC also provides examples of transportation plans and plan elements that are also just a useful guide in terms of what others have done in transportation planning. On our website, we also have previous certification reports, so you can see what comments that we made on previous plan updates and any other kind of outstanding issues that we noted from the 2015-16 updates. Certainly, these are really good resources, but we're also just as staff available if you have questions along the way. So please feel free to reach out and contact us. We are happy to answer questions that you may have. In terms of some of our data resources, I think transportation staff will talk a little bit about other kind of visualization tools we have, but we think our new community profiles are also a really helpful guide and resource for transportation planning. This mostly provides a look at census information, other types of data information that is available by jurisdiction. As part of the community profiles, we also have a little tab that includes relevant projects in our TIP, as well as the regional transportation plan. So this is a really great resource for cross-checking and making sure you're consistent with our regional transportation plan project list. So a great new resource from us. We also, of course, have gotten a lot of questions about forecast products for modeling, and we are working on updating our land use vision growth projections. This is a data product that is consistent with the new growth targets, as well as the regional growth strategy and vision 2050, and will include outputs for the year 2044, which is really helpful for our plan update. And this is really intended to support travel modeling and analysis that you'll be doing as part of the plan updates. We anticipate releasing that product by the end of this year. So coming soon, if you have questions or need things in the meantime, you can feel free to reach out to our data staff who can help provide the resources that we do have available. I just wanted to flag from our previous certification round, just some of the things that we have come across in terms of technical issues, things that you just might want to watch out for as part of your plan updates. I think one thing that comes up frequently, or has come up every time basically, is this issue of alignment between comprehensive plan elements. So transportation modeling maybe was done at a different time, or was done out of house and wasn't as consistent with the rest of the plan. So we've seen this come up again and again, but just want to make sure that that's something to be aware of in terms of consistency between plan elements, because that's something that we do look for. And related to that is consistency with the growth targets that have been adopted at the countywide level. We also have seen over time just some missing transportation plan requirements, like incomplete project lists or financing plans. In the last plan updates, we saw some incomplete or missing bicycle pedestrian components. We've also seen a few plans that identified projects on state facilities that the state wasn't actually planning for. So it's also something we look for in terms of consistency with our project lists. So just some things to look out for in terms of issues we've come up with in the past. We have a lot of guidance on our website that I just wanted to make sure folks are aware of. We have a page called the Vision 2050 Planning Resources that includes a lot of guidance that helps support other plan elements, as well as other topics related to tribal coordination, equitable engagement, TOD, as well as climate. So lots of really great resources on our website beyond just the transportation element. So with that, I'm going to stop sharing, and we'll pass it over to Gil to talk a bit about our transportation planning policies and vision and the transportation one.
Thank you, Liz. I'm getting it set for presentation mode. My name is Gil Cerise. I'm a program manager in transportation planning at Puget Sound Regional Council. And as Liz mentioned, I'm going to give a brief overview of some regional policy direction, Vision 2050 and the regional transportation plan before we dive into the specific topics, some example topics for transportation element guidance. And I think many of you probably seen this policy framework graphic that we show here, kind of showing how regional planning fits into the overall framework. We have at the state level Growth Management Act, guiding planning across the state. In our region, Vision 2050 provides the regional growth strategy, and the regional transportation plan gives guidance on how that's implemented in the transportation element. And then that provides guidance down to the local jurisdictions. As you all know, Vision 2050 has extended our planning horizon out to 2050, allowing you as local jurisdictions giving you some knowledge and information about what growth will look like up to a longer, further out planning horizon. You're able to then take that information and use that for your 2044 planning horizons you're all working towards with this comp plan update. And this graphic though is intended to kind of show the iterative planning process. So as you're looking at out to your new planning horizon to 2044 and the land uses that are out there, identify that provides some opportunity for you to look at what are the mobility challenges and opportunities that you have, and that turns itself into projects and kind of looking at how the work that you do at local comprehensive plans, transit agency plans, and transportation improvement programs, that work and you're doing in trying to figure out how to accommodate the additional population and employment in your local jurisdiction, then translates into projects. Those projects then go through, go back to the region, and we look at that at the regional transportation plan. There's this review process to make sure that they're consistent with Vision 2050 and the regional growth strategy. If they are, they're added into the regional transportation plan, and that's the iterative planning process. So our planning at the regional level informs your local planning. Your local planning translates into projects and come back into the regional transportation plan. So just to let you know, that's kind of how this works. It really is an iterative planning process that is important that we're doing good work at the regional level and that we're taking the good work you're doing at the local level into account. Another element here, kind of another point we want to make, was land use and transportation linkages and the importance of that. Land use is fundamental to transportation in the region and the types of choices that we can make in our transportation, how we move people and goods throughout this region. The regional transportation plan at the regional level is similar to your transportation element at the local level, where Vision 2050 is equivalent to your comprehensive plan, providing that land use vision and guidance to your community. Vision 2050 provides that regional growth strategy for the region and informs your local comprehensive plans. Similarly, the transportation element that you're developing, that helps implement that land use plan and establishes guidance at the local level, similar to what the regional transportation plan does at the regional level. And this reinforces the need, kind of Liz was alluding to the internal consistency aspects, right? Making sure that you're working together, your planning departments and your public works departments are working together as the comprehensive plan is being updated and the land use assumptions and elements are being addressed, that's really the transportation element that you're developing is consistent with that. And that ensures the land use plan, transportation strategies and investments and financial strategy work together to achieve your local community goals. And finally, before turning it over to diving into some planning for projects, I wanted to kind of share with you some resources we have. And I think I'll probably update this slide for the website that we include some links to it. I realize that probably would be useful for everyone. We have a transportation system visualization tool that was developed as part of our most recent RTP. It identifies multimodal transportation inventories, land use connections, existing and future conditions, and transportation investments at a regional level. So as an example, you can identify where existing transit routes are, the transit facilities. And then you can also look out into the future. Where are the planned transit routes? As we see Sound Transit expanding its high capacity transit system, local bus agencies and ferry agencies, where they're planning their future routes and services. And then we also even have an overlay for that future planning with what we know as best we know for densities and transit supportive densities, which I'll talk about in a moment. So that's just an example of the kinds of things you can find in that visualization tool. And I encourage you all to look at that as you're planning and developing your comprehensive plans. We also have some guidance on advancing equity through transportation and on climate change, including the region's four-part strategy out for reducing emissions. So these are cross-cutting areas that we're kind of continuing to have emerging work on these topic areas. So we encourage you to kind of look at that guidance as you're planning, doing your comprehensive plan updates and your transportation element updates. And then finally, we have a resilience map that identifies natural hazards. And so we want to make sure that jurisdictions are taking that into account as they develop transportation elements, addressing mobility needs into the future, and that resilience is a key component of that as well. So we have those things and more on our website. And again, we'll include links in that for the topics afterwards. I believe this is my last slide on the regional context. And so at this point, I'll turn things over to Jennifer Barnes to talk about planning for projects. And I will stop sharing here.
Thank you, Gil. And I will start sharing here. All right. Good morning, everybody. I am Jennifer Barnes, and I am a program manager in PSRC's Transportation Planning Department. And I am here to talk about planning for projects in your transportation element. But I'll start where we usually start at PSRC when we're talking about planning, and that is with Vision 2050, which strongly emphasizes the development of a multimodal transportation system that encourages walking, biking, and transit, and accommodates the movement of goods throughout the region and in door-to-door deliveries, and reduces dependence on driving alone. These policies are implemented at the regional level through the Regional Transportation Plan, as Gil mentioned, and this recognizes that an efficient and fair transportation system must serve diverse demands. Well-maintained streets and highways and bridges should provide safe and efficient routes for cars and buses and freight haulers and delivery trucks, as well as for people walking and rolling and biking. Adequate sidewalks and pathways should provide safe walking routes to local jurisdictions. Infrastructure should be provided that provides safe and convenient routes for those who want a bicycle. Reliable and high frequent, high capacity, and local transit should be connected to these other modes of transportation and link important concentrations of jobs and housing and services, recreation, and other regional amenities. So all of these components should work together, providing diverse mobility options in an integrated transportation system. The Regional Transportation Plan also recognizes that investment in maintenance and preservation is a critical component of sustaining an efficient transportation system. So as Gil discussed, vision and the Regional Transportation Plan provide the overarching framework within which transportation elements are developed within our region at the local level. Within this framework, a transportation element should emphasize all modes by which people travel and goods are moved throughout all of its components. This includes through development of the transportation policies, inventories, development of standards by which the adequacy of the transportation network is measured, analyses of existing and future conditions, development of projects and programs to ensure that the adequacy of the transportation system occurs, and a financial plan that shows how your agency expects to pay for improvements and maintenance of the complete transportation network now and into the future. And just to reemphasize Gil and Liz's earlier words, the interrelationship between a comprehensive plan's land use element and transportation element is very strong. In planning under Vision 2050, future development growth should be focused in designated centers and near transit stations. Land use densities combined with land use policies and development regulations that help manage parking and support walking, biking, and transit help direct growth patterns that can be more efficiently accommodated with these travel modes. Then in turn, prioritizing investments in growth centers that support walking, biking, and transit helps facilitate growth patterns that are consistent with vision. So we just really want to emphasize, if we haven't already enough, that transportation element is just very strongly linked to the land use element and generally requires great collaboration between the planning and public works sides of an agency. So to be more explicit in multimodal planning, we ask that jurisdictions within our region specifically develop standards by which the adequacy of non-automobile modes can be assessed. This can be in addition to or integrated with standards by which automobile travel is evaluated. And the main purpose of this is twofold. First, it encourages planning for walking, biking, and transit modes to be proactive and explicit. And second, it facilitates transparency in how facilities to support these modes of travel are assessed and improved and prioritized. So development of multimodal standards just leads to more active planning in support of these modes of travel, rather than having it be something that's handled indirectly or not at all. So also consistent with the Growth Management Act, we ask that jurisdictions within the region incorporate the development of multimodal standards into comprehensive plan and transportation element development. We don't mandate how that should be done. So I'm going to share three examples of how different jurisdictions have handled this in different ways in their most recent transportation elements. And the first is the City of Buckley, which developed a system to define and apply a level of service grade to sidewalks. This is in addition to more conventional level of service standards applied to vehicle operations and has a similar look. What I think is notable in this example is that there is a clear line between the standard that's been defined and how a deficiency is identified according to that standard. Then the transportation element identifies the projects to address deficiencies and then carries that through to developing the costs of these projects. My next example is from the City of Normandy Park. There are several jurisdictions that apply an approach along these lines, which is to adopt mode-specific thresholds for pedestrian, bicycle, and sometimes transit, by which facilities are determined to be sufficient. And then they apply kind of traffic light colors in this assessment, which can be shown on a map. So green generally identifies that a facility meets the defined threshold. Red generally identifies a gap or deficiency, and yellow often indicates something in between. Like this could be something like a facility that has a sidewalk, but it's narrower than what the city standards would prescribe. Or in this example, a sidewalk on one side of the street along major streets where a sidewalk on both sides are desired. These types of mode-specific standards are typically in addition to level of service standards that are applied to vehicle traffic. The key with this type of approach is that once these mode-specific standards are established, that they be carried through the rest of the steps of the transportation element development, that they be applied to identify which facilities are adequate and where deficiencies exist that need to be addressed. And then for those deficiencies, that projects or programs are identified to address them, and that the costs of the projects or programs are included in the financial plan. My third example, My third example comes from the City of Bellevue, which has developed and implemented a full multimodal concurrency policy. In Bellevue's approach, person trips generated by new development is evaluated by mode and then converted into mobility units. And the mobility unit calculation takes into account basically the space in the transportation network needed to accommodate a trip, so that a walking or biking or transit trip that takes less space in the system converts to a lower unit than a single occupant vehicle that takes up more space in the system. And then the mobility units that are calculated are applied to basically a bank that the city has established in its analysis. So the takeaway here is that there's a variety of approaches that could potentially be applied in the development of multimodal standards. We recognize that each city or county has its own unique characteristics and that the approaches that are applied will vary. And while we have policies that are, you know, supporting the development of these multimodal standards, we do have flexibility in how they are applied. The key, getting back to my earlier slide, is that the approach is clear and transparent. The multimodal standards that are applied should be defined through policy, then applied in transportation analysis. For any deficiencies that are identified by applying the standard, a project or program or strategy should be identified to address the deficiency, and that should be included in the financial plan developed for the transportation element. So now I'll talk a little about the development of financially constrained transportation project lists. I've talked previously about the strong, we've all talked previously about the strong interrelationship in comprehensive plans between the land use and transportation elements, but the development of the financial plan to show how the transportation improvements will be paid for is the essential third part of the balance that needs to be struck. As shown here simply, the land use plan is developed to accommodate future growth. Through development of the transportation element, transportation strategies, projects, and programs are identified to ensure that the transportation system can support that growth. And a financial plan is developed to show how these projects and programs will be paid for. This is a requirement under GMA, but it's also what makes your transportation element implementable. So here I just want to talk through some considerations in development of the project list itself. Even though we often all refer to this simply as a project list, it should include all types of improvements that have been identified to support land use. The project list should definitely include capital projects that have been identified, but it should also include programs such as pavement overlays and signal upgrades and other maintenance and preservation programs that are needed to keep the transportation system running. Things like ADA transition plans, transportation demand management programs should also be included. If the plan recommendations include any transportation studies needed for a particular topic, then that study should be included on the list as well. So basically anything that would need to be included by your agency's or in your agency's transportation improvement program in order to be implemented either in the near future or farther down the line should be included on this project list. For projects and programs that are identified, there should be information provided that shows the purpose of the project and links to the policies and standards that have been defined, and also the scope and needed timing for that project or program. And so here, I'm just gonna walk through kind of the standard building blocks of a financially constrained project list. And I will just point out that what I'm talking through is applying on the local scale, an approach that is consistent with the approach that is applied on the regional scale in the RTP, the Regional Transportation Plan Financial Strategy. And so here just have kind of a simple depiction, and at the bottom line is that the costs of all these projects and programs that are defined on your 20-year list need to be balanced, be equal to the revenue that are forecast over the life of the plan. And so first, the blue box of just the cost side, the project list that I was just talking about that include the total costs, as I mentioned, to include all transportation projects and programs identified to support the future land use plan. And it's important that all of the projects be identified through the life of the project. This is a 20-year plan that is typically developed for comprehensive plans. And so the list needs to be a 20-year list of all of the investments that will be needed to support that land use plan, including everything, as I mentioned, not only capital projects, but everything else that goes along with maintaining that. On the revenue side, there's a couple of steps to this. First is identifying basically what we in the regional transportation plan refer to as current law revenue. And that's the revenue that would be generated just by continuing the revenue generating mechanisms that are already in place. And so this often is, it's still a forecast because it's in the future, but these are sources of revenue that that are in place that have implementing mechanisms in place and that can be relied upon in the future. The first 6 years of revenue, we would expect to be very consistent with kind of the financial constraint that goes with the transportation improvement program. Should be accounted for within fairly tight budgetary constraints, and you would expect that the first 6 years of your transportation element financial plan is basically what's going to feed the first TIP, transportation improvement program, that comes out of this process. The remaining year's revenues should be accounted for as well. And realizing that farther in the future becomes more of a forecast than funding is secured, but still applying reasonable assumptions. And typically this consists of, you know, knowing the revenue stream that has been generated in the past, if it can be reasonably assumed to continue into the future, then that is a reasonable assumption to make for future financial plans. And even things like grants, it's acceptable to assume future grant funding in these future financial plans, but generally to be reasonable, you look at what you've generated in the past for grant funding, and it may be reasonable to assume that we can continue to secure funding at that rate or at some rate into the future, as long as there's a basis for making that assumption. It's not generally reasonable to say our entire future funding gap is gonna get filled with gaps. So it's really just like all modeling, I mean, and forecasting, looking at historical trends and kind of what your agency has been able to secure in the past, projecting that into the future. And then there is this last piece that if once you've done that and you've made your reasonable forecasts based on historical trends into the future and the funding mechanisms that are in place for your agency, if there is still a gap between the total cost of the project list and the revenues that are being forecast, then that is the area where these additional revenue sources need to be identified. So these can be mechanisms that possibly could be considered by your agency or by your electeds or by your voting community, but haven't been secured. And so for these types of potential but unsecured funding sources, we would ask that the potential steps to securing that additional revenue be identified and the implementation steps be discussed. And then just that is what completes the plan. Here's our total cost. Here's the revenue that we feel is we can reasonably forecast for the future. Here's the gap. Here's some potential sources that we have identified where this, how this gap could be filled. And then here are the steps that would be needed in order to turn that from a potential source to an actual source that we can rely on. And then part of the just requirements under GMA after all of that does include just a discussion of how your jurisdiction will address potential funding shortfalls through a reassessment of everything that I've been talking about, should that come to be needed in the future. So I'm my example to illustrate this, I am pointing out how City of Edmonds has handled that, because City of Edmonds financial plan really does include all of these steps. And I know this font is very small and the details of the projects listed are not that important, but a few things that I'm going to point out are that the transportation improvement plan, you can see that there's actually two columns of finances here. The city has called out what their more immediate six-year needs as of the time of the last plan are. And so basically this column here, you would expect to be kind of pulled into the first transportation improvement program that comes out of the transportation element. But even though they have a six-year list of where the priorities are, they also have their long-range list of here are the investments that are needed through the end of the life of the plan, in this case through 2035. So everything is listed, capital projects definitely on this list, but things like the annual street overlays are on the list, signal improvement programs, debt service to previous projects, that these are future expenses. And so they've got that included in their financial plan. ADA transition is in here. They have one study, as I mentioned. So basically everything that needs to be implemented to on the transportation side to support the future growth or land use growth as defined in their land use element is identified on this list. And then with the with the programs and projects and costs identified in the previous list, the next table identifies all of those potential transportation revenues based on the current mechanisms that the city has in place. So they do have some assumption for grants based on what their historical trend has been for securing grants for transportation projects. And then other sources of funding that the city has in place to pay for transportation projects. So these are all identified very explicitly in their plan, but then there's still a gap between the total revenues that have been forecast and the total costs of the project list that I showed on the previous slide. And so there's this third table that identifies the other potential sources of revenue to pay for the transportation plan. And in the plan itself, there is a discussion of what would be needed to implement one or more of these additional sources of revenue. And so the last slide here before I turn it over to Kyle, in talking about just the development of projects in particular, is that under GMA and definitely as part of the Vision 2050 and our regional policies, that coordination with other agencies is very critical piece of this whole process. In many different ways. So there's coordinating to account for planned projects by other jurisdictions that are, you know, going to affect transportation in your jurisdiction. So taking those into account as part of your future planning. Do you want to point out that only projects on your agency's financially constrained list should be projects over which your agency actually has jurisdiction? And that kind of in between where there's partnerships needed, that any projects that are developed in, you know, that require partnerships, that conversation and that coordination take place as part of your transportation element development. So with that, I will turn it over to one of our primary partners in transportation element development, and that is Kyle Miller from WashDOT's Statewide Planning Office.
Hey, thank you very much. Flop this over. All right, I'm assuming you can see everything now. Thank you again. I appreciate you giving me the introduction. My name is Kyle Miller. I'm a transportation planning specialist with the Washington State Department of Transportation. I work out of our statewide planning office. Yeah, I'm here today to talk to you about the community planning portal and actually the community planning portal 2.0. Some of you may have known in the past that we have the community planning portal. And this is a great tool that we put together, I don't know, probably to 2013, 2014, kind of during the first round of the last round of the GMA updates. So I'm just going to kind of let you know that the community planning portal is a great spot. It's an online forum for state, regional, and local transportation planners to really share transportation data and land use. It's a mapping and data sharing platform that you can share with your other partners and really get some good information using ArcGIS Online. And one of the good things about it is that anyone can really use it. You don't have to have an ArcGIS Online account or anything like that. You can view WashDOT data and other content information as well. And really you can use any browser, although it does work best in Google Chrome. So the reason why we really created the community planning portal was to really help with the 2015 to 2018 GMA update schedule. And now we were in the process of just revamping it, giving it a little bit better feel, make it a little bit more intuitive for the 24 to 27 update cycle that's going on right now. So again, with this, why we created the portal, we really wanted to provide data on the state transportation system. At the time, it was hard to get transportation data from WashDOT without having to jump through a bunch of hoops. Now, this ArcGIS Online has allowed us to really put our stuff out there without having to make it difficult for folks to try and get the information. It really does help with understanding the context of each jurisdiction, so you can kind of see what's going on in your specific area. And we're hoping that this really does lead to closer partnerships so that we can all work together to identify opportunities to like operate more efficiently, really manage demand more effectively, and invest more strategically. So here I am with Community Planning 2.0, and I'll show a quick demonstration of this in a few minutes. We've modernized the original version of the Community Planning Portal. We configured it by using an ArcGIS Online web app, which allowed us for more functionality and gave a little bit more of a better user experience. We used categories to structure the data and resources, so we kind of put like items together. We just basically overall mirrored what the original community planning portal was. We just kind of enhanced the usability of it. So let me pull this up real quick. So I'll put a link in the chat but you obviously will get this presentation too, so you can kind of poke through this at the time whenever you have a moment. but this is the community planning portal. I'm going to look this way, so I'm looking at my other screen right now. It's pretty simple. It's all kind of turn on and off the data sets. Basically, this is an ArcGIS Online application, so everything that we have has gone through, everything Wash.Author has gone through a data update and made sure everything is as current as possible. We do use other, we leverage other existing resources from different state or national data sources, but we make sure that they are the most current version that we have out there. But basically, you can zoom in and out. You can go search to I'll just search into a certain spot so you can kind of see if I can spell Seattle right. You can zoom into an area, you can turn on data. Every one of these data sets does have some sort of pop-up window associated with each of the data sources that are available. Everything that's been Wash.Authored, you can go take a quicker look at or a deeper look at, understand the metadata, understand some of the show item details that are available out there. You should see on all the Wash.Author data sets, you should see some sort of flying T, green text, basically saying that this is developed by Wash.Dot. Should provide you descriptions or all the Wash.Dot layers and kind of like terms of use where you can go actually see the actual location of the data. It's got some few tags here and there. You can open it up in different viewers. You can bring it right into ArcGIS desktop too if you were working on something at your desk and you needed some more information. And you can also see the metadata, kind of see where things are at or see exactly what is in the data. Go back here. And I know I'm going through this fairly fast, but if you have any questions, my contact information stuff is in the presentation. You can always reach out to me. We really want to make sure that you guys get the information that you need from us to help, especially update the transportation element. Also, if you're putting something together for your area, you're also able to add data to this application pretty easily. You can just go out to the add data, and go out to ArcGIS Online where you can have, you can get thousands of different data sources, available for you to download, in your area. You just got to make sure that you're using something that is, reputable, and you're not using something that you know isn't a very good source. But you can go out, and I can just go out to the ArcGIS Online and add data as simple as just going in, finding the data. I just typed in PSRC. Excuse me. So you can see a lot of this stuff has been tagged with PSRC. But simply by adding the data set, I guess obviously sometimes it doesn't fail. You gotta love live. Okay, there we go. You gotta love live demos sometimes, right? it brings in the information that you come right to your map. So, and you can filter and do all the things that you need to, but you can see that this was probably a Wash.Dot authored map at some point, but PSRC or somebody had put it together. Get the information that's there. Sorry about that. But you can flip through and see exactly what layers are open and get the information that you can. some of the other information you can do is you can open the tables. You can see the attribute table. You can filter off the attribute tables for that. So if you're really just looking for something within a city, you can filter off that in this case. We also just kind of give some basic functionality with the tool. You can kind of zoom in and out as you see here. You can also just zoom in and out with your wheel on your mouse or double click. It should take you in and out of the map. this kind of gives you just some information about what's in the within the portal, just so people can kind of get an understanding of what it is. Like I said, you can add, you can change the base maps to the map itself. So if you didn't like the gray, you know, you can add anything you really want. You can change the background and make it look different. These up here on the top right are basically we basically grouped this section on the left in here in like items. So we put a boundary section together. We got multimodal type work, planning type stuff. We kind of tried lumping all of the like items together so it makes it a little easier for the users. Just be aware that as you see maybe this environmental PSRC state bridges, when you add a data set to this map right now, you add it to every one of these icons. Let's see here. Basically, you got your save and your measure tool and all the other stuff too, so you can kind of get a better idea of maybe where a project is in relation to a resource or some sort of attribute. You can draw, do little map notes and everything else on there. I know that's kind of a quick overview of what the community planning portal is, but we have found that when we initially put it together for the first GMA update, it really was used quite a bit by the local governments around the state. WSDOT also uses it more so, not just for planning, but for other things. We found that it's multidisciplined, so we can use it for different parts of our work. And that's that with that. I wanted to provide a few other resources for you. So when you get this presentation, you can kind of poke through some of the stuff, but basically some land use transportation planning, our transportation efficient communities work, some complete street stuff, a link to our active transportation plan, some funding type work as well. And basically, let's see here. for the community planning portal, we're always looking for constructive feedback. So if you come across a layer that you may think would be great for you and for others, we're not opposed to maybe putting together, working together to put some sort of data set together. We really do like making sure we kind of fill in some of those gaps that you guys may need when it comes to data sets. So we're always looking to have that conversation. I'm assuming some of you guys may be aware of the Community Planning Portal 1.0. We retired that on August 1st, so this is the newest version of it. There's the link to the portal itself. And then you can always provide some feedback. So I also just wanted to briefly mention that, in past comprehensive plan updates, we're really interested in engaging with the locals, jurisdictions, in their planning process, reviewing the elements and ensuring alignment with the state projects and programs. So I know there's been discussions like with the Northwest Olympic regions with their staff who are really trying to plan out the engagement letters and send those out soon. So just kind of keep an eye open for that. Those letters will have a centralized email address for submittals and staff contact information as well. Let's see. So I know that the regions also have been in touch with some of the PSRC plan review staff, and I'm sure that they'd be really happy to provide the right WSDOT staff contact for you, especially on particular topics. Prior to your agency really receiving those engagement letters. So look for those pretty soon. One last thing I forgot to mention, going back into the application, we have links to our website itself. So the Community Planning Portal website, this is still under construction because I'm transitioning it from the 1.0 to the 2.0. So there's a couple links in here that are that kind of work still with the 2.0, but they're more focused towards 1.0. But we have some videos understanding the basic functionality of the 2.0. So if you haben't ever really looked at ArcGIS Online or a web app of some sort, you can watch this little video here. I think it's less than 10 minutes. And it'll basically just kind of walk you through some of the basic steps of the portal. But I'm always open for a conversation. Here's my information. And I think really with that, I'm going to turn it over to Gil and Thomas now. As soon as I find my...
Actually, Kyle, I think that we're going to pause here for a moment and field any of the questions that we've come in. We only have a few coming in so far. There have been some questions and apologies, two apologies. First, my name is Kelly McGurdy. I'm the Director of Transportation Planning here at PSRC, and I'm going to be fielding our Q&A sessions. And I also want to apologize to everyone on the webinar. I have a rogue smoke alarm battery going off somewhere in my house, so it is beeping. I will deal with it once the webinar is over, but apologies if that is distracting for all of you. We've received a couple of questions related to asking about slides and various links. And I know Liz has provided some of those direct links in the chat. And each of the presenters is also providing some of that. And I'll also share that the presenters coming up also have some links to share. The guidance document coming out will provide some direct links, and the website that Liz has mentioned will also have some direct links. So I encourage everyone to put your questions in specific for Jennifer and Kyle. But there is one question, and I think, Jennifer, I'm going to send this to you, but Liz, you might also want to weigh in on that. And it's a really great question and kind of a fundamental question. And that is, as local jurisdictions are updating their comprehensive plans, you mentioned, Jennifer, the interactive nature between the transportation element and transportation planning and the land use element and land use planning. And the question really is, I think it's a little bit of that chicken and the egg question, right? Does the transportation element lead the land use element, or is it the reverse? Does land use and zoning help to design transportation needs? I know that's a complicated question, but I thought if you and or Liz would like to maybe elaborate a little bit on that, I think that'd be great.
Yeah, I'll give it a shot, and Liz, feel free to add on. I would say in general, the land use plan leads transportation with kind of a qualifier, because transportation considerations guide the land use decision, right? So the reason for encouraging growth to occur in designated centers and around transit aid stations in particular, what that is considering is that it is more efficient to provide transportation, not only transportation services, but public services in general, with the type of growth patterns that Vision 2050 is supports. So kind of fundamentally, we start with the land use plan, then the analysis is done to determine the not only transportation, but the other services and utilities and everything else that needs to support that land use plan. And then, as I mentioned, then the finances come into play, and that all has to be balanced. So depending on the kind of the outcome of all of that, there can be some iteration involved between land use and transportation, as opposed to, considering what are the right combination of strategies. And sometimes transportation and other analyses are used to test different land use plans to see what the effects are. I don't know if that answered the question, but I see Liz has her camera on too, so I will let Liz add to that.
No, I think that's a really great response tonight, and I agree with what you stated. I would also just add that, so Vision 2050 really also, more than previous plans, emphasizes transit-oriented development and growth around high-capacity transit. So we're making these like generational investments in transit. So there's part of it too that's like we want to encourage growth near those transit investments. But I think for the most part, Jennifer really describes the way that it sort of functions in terms of the transportation element.
Terrific. Thanks to you both. Kyle, this is a question for you. If folks wanted to access the kind of underlying GIS data for the information that's provided in the community portal, who would they contact and how would they obtain that?
So a lot of the data that we have is in our WASH.online map center for ArcGIS Online. I guess depending on what the data source was, if it's a publicly facing data source or if it was more of something that was kind of meant for internal audiences or stuff like that, it would depend on who we can talk to. I'm more than willing to field some of those questions and turn those folks over to the right people. A lot of the data sources that we have within the agency are, they're stewarded by each individual office or by each group. So there's, let's say there's planning data, there's engineering data, there's, public transportation data, and so on and so forth. A lot of the information that, especially like within the portal itself, if you go into this show item details link that I was showing earlier, some of the contact information and who to actually contact will be in there as well. So, but I'm always up for helping out somebody. I can point directions and do that, no problem. So Perfect. Reach out to me directly.
Perfect, thank you. Jennifer, back to you. With respect to project lists, do these need to be in the transportation element, or can the element refer to the TIP, which is updated annually?
So I'll start by just differentiating that the comprehensive plan is a planning document, right? This is the long range plan looking into many years into the future, 20 years into the future, whereas the TIP is a program document. And that really is identifying here are the project and here's the funding source. So they're obviously very closely related, but they do kind of serve different purposes. As far as the program document really is, here's our spending plan for the next definitely 6 years. And then sometimes often the TIPs will identify kind of beyond the 6 year, but they're really meant to be the 6 year financially constrained document. So with respect to the project lists, just getting back to the project list does need to include all of the projects through the life of the plan, which generally extends beyond kind of the timeframe of a typical 6 year TIP. So they need to be consistent, but they do serve different purposes. As far as the plan the project list itself in like just the logistics of a project list in a transportation element, agencies do handle it in different ways. Sometimes the transportation element, that kind of the main document, is generally the policy document. And there might be technical appendices that have all of this additional information with the analyses and the project lists, but they're in there. Some transportation elements have that all information, straight in their main plan text. So I think that, I would say in generally just referring to the TIP is probably not going to be adequate, because it's not going to have all of the context and the information that would be provided in the transportation element project list that then generally would it be expected to feed the TIP and the continuing, TIP updates, annual TIP updates from year to year that comes out of that larger transportation project list. I don't know if Liz or Kelly, if you have anything to add to that.
No. So I knew we were going to get at least one question related to certification. So this one's going to be a little bit of the more challenging question. And Jennifer, I see you turned your camera off, but I think I might make you turn it back on. This is both, again, both to Jennifer and Liz. And this has to do with what's going to be required for folks to receive certification of their transportation element. And in this case, the question has to do with the multimodal level of service standards. And the specific question is, in order to be certified, are we expecting local jurisdictions to somehow integrate these various level of service standards they might have for specific modes? And I think the question is, or I think the answer is potentially, no, there's flexibility for each jurisdiction to address these things in the way that they see fit. But there's my prompt to one or both of you to field that particular question.
Well, I'll give it a start. And I definitely want Liz to chime in on this as our head certifier. I guess the messages we want to get out there is consistent with what I was saying in my part of the presentation, is that we do ask that everybody do this. There is a lot of flexibility from our perspective on how this be done. So I think the important thing is that line between your policies and your standards and your analysis and your recommendations, that there is a through line between all of that and the relationship between all of those steps are clear. But as far as the mechanics of how you do this, we do acknowledge there's going to be just variations depending on each jurisdiction's kind of unique characteristics and circumstances. And as long as that's clear, then you are following the spirit of this guidance from our perspective. So Liz can confirm or clarify or correct what I just said.
I think that's a good response. I mean, this has been in, this was in Vision 2040 before, this is now in Vision 2050. And so I think we're looking for progress on this issue. And I think that what Jennifer described is that we understand for jurisdictions of different sizes, this might look a little bit different, but that there are ways to incorporate this, even for smaller jurisdictions, of like identifying standards that can help inform kind of project lists and the work that you're doing on multimodal planning. So I think that we're hoping for progress in this area. We made a number of comments as part of the last certification reports. And so I would say if there was a comment in your last certification report about it, that's something you should take note of. But yeah, this will likely look a bit different depending on the size and scale.
Okay, and we just have a few minutes. We did receive a question related to communities that don't have high capacity transit, and I'm just gonna let that person know. I think the next series of presenters are gonna talk about transit, so we'll hold that question. Then a new question, and then if we have time, Kyle, I might ask you to bring up your portal up again. This next question is, do you have any guidance regarding annual updates to the TIP, the CIP, or the Capital Facilities Program? Can these things be combined? They're on different deadlines. And I don't know that this is an area that I'm less experienced with, but Jennifer, I expect you have a little bit more insight there. And I don't know the relationship to the comp plan update, but they're asking specifically about these three unique documents, the TIP, the CIP, and the CFP, if they can somehow be combined, or if we have guidance that we're touching on that.
My experience with this is that the capital facilities plan is more of the long range. Here are all of, not only transportation, it's more inclusive than just transportation, right? The capital facilities plan is not only the transportation facilities and services needed to basically accommodate long-term growth, but also utilities and services and parks and everything else that that each jurisdiction needs to plan for and maintain throughout, you know, as just part of the public process. The capital improvement program is also a broader document, right? That tends to be also a six-year document. That's the city's budgets. It includes everything. So not just transportation, police and city government and utilities, if appropriate, and everything, and parks. And so all of the projects that are basically programmed across the jurisdiction are included in the capital improvement program. And then the transportation improvement program is really that subset of the capital improvement program that is specifically about the transportation. So generally you see something called a capital improvement program that would be a city or a county's budget document for the next 6 years, updated every year. One piece of that would be the transportation improvement program that's specifically the transportation projects that are developed.
Perfect. That was really helpful. And I'm going to close out this section. And before we turn it back over to Gil, Kyle, I put you on notice. We have a question about the environmental health disparity layer in the community portal and how that's used by WashDOT to achieve the intent of the HEAL Act. And so I wonder, two questions. One is, do you have any specific information related to kind of the use of that? But also they're asking if, I think we have a moment, if you could pull up the community portal and just kind of demonstrate how to pull that up.
Yeah, so good question. We have, so Department of Health just recently updated their data for the equity EHD data set. Right now, what we have up is the old version of 1.0. We haven't updated the second version yet. We are in the process of doing so. So let's see, the easiest way for me to, let's see here. Sometimes it's just kind of scroll through and find it real fast. So basically what this version of the, this is the overall ranking. Department of Health has that on the open data source. They have basically their 1.0 and their 1.1 and their 2.0 data sources out there for you to download. You can download them directly to your ArcGIS Online or ArcGIS Online account. I work on them on desktop. We are using this. We brought it in because we wanted to use some of the stuff for our highway system plan update that's going on. And we're really looking at the transportation infrastructures that have impacted, you know, some of the communities based on the 9 and 10 rankings or the top 20%. So this version here, I have to update and bring on the 2.0. So this is the older version. I think Department of Health has updated their data source the end of August or beginning of September or something like that. So we just haven't had a chance to get it up there. But if you want to go out and get it, you can get it directly from the open data. I think it's on the data.wa.gov site. And you can just basically search for EHD and you'll see our Department of Health data, and you'll see them pop up. And they've clearly marked current version and not current version on the data sources, so you can get the right data source. And that basically provides, from what I recall, all 19 data sources within their data, and you can look at it that way. And then there was one other question too about.
No, I think that covered it. They were just asking one to kind of visualize how to turn that layer on and just kind of understanding a little bit more about how that data was going to be used.
Yeah. Okay. And we have a HELOC that we're working with in WSDOT with a bunch of state agencies as well. We are just kind of experimenting how to put this data source out and not really change much, obviously, what Department of Health has put together, because they've done a lot of work and a lot of good stuff with the especially this most current update that they've just done. So.
All right. Terrific. Thank you, Kyle. Thanks, Kyle and Jennifer. And I'll turn it back over to Gil.
Thank you, Kelly. I'm going to get to sharing my screen here and start talking about planning for transit. So let's make sure I get this going on the presentation mode. I think everyone can see my presentation mode now. Again, Gil Solis, Program Manager in Transportation Planning. And I just wanted to kind of set the context here. A lot of good information so far on kind of preparing transportation elements. But this next series of slides will talk about kind of a conundrum that local jurisdictions may have, planning for transit. And we've taken, with Vision 2050, have created what was formerly a transit-focused growth strategy and made it even more transit-focused. And yet, in many cases, most cases, public transportation is not provided by or planned for by necessarily, or at least provided by the local jurisdictions. They're provided by another local entity or regional entity. And so how do you plan for transit in your long range plans and your comprehensive plans? So in this section of the webinar, I'd like to share some strategies and kind of resources and guidance on how jurisdictions can plan for transit and to achieve your community vision. I'm going to be relying upon a selection of some resources and work, some strategies and identification of ideas coming out of some work that PSRC has done in the last few years and kind of updated through our regional transportation plan that's adopted earlier this year. And before I dive into that, I want to just acknowledge, I think there, Kelly alluded to, if you don't have a high capacity transit, but how about even if you don't have transit? So when we talk about planning for transit, I think a lot of what we're going to be talking about here is focusing on our two regional providers, Sound Transit, and providing rail and bus service through three of our four counties, Washington State Ferries, connecting communities across Puget Sound, and five other agencies that provide fixed route public transportation, transit that runs on a fixed route at fixed times of the day. Also to acknowledge, though, that there are other services out there. There are human service providers. There are those that promote use of transit and other modes of transportation, multimodal transportation, that I'm going to be trying to touch on in the upcoming slides here. So if I don't touch on that, please hit me with some questions on this afterwards. But before I dive in here, there's going to be three kind of areas that are covered in our Transit Supportive Planning Toolkit PSRC produced a few years ago: coordinating land use and transit, supporting multimodal mobility, and connecting people to transit. So those will be the kind of the framework for these next few slides before I turn it over to Thomas. So initially, we'll start off kind of reinforcing something that I think you've heard over and over again today: coordinating land use and transit. And so transit really does rely upon compact mixed-use development near transit. And really, where does a local jurisdiction that doesn't operate transit, where do they have influence over that over transit and where it goes into the future? You have that influence in how you set the table and set your land use context. So planning for transit-oriented development that achieves transit-supportive densities in station areas is really important. That produces the market for transit agencies to be able to support transit services into the future. The more density you provide, the higher the higher capacity transit can be provided. And so I just wanted to kind of make a cross-reference here. PSOC's produced transit supportive density paper in the past. That's still relevant information for you all to use as you're looking into this. And I already referenced that our transportation visualization tool does include kind of layers that overlay transit supportive densities and future transit routing. We also encourage a more finer tuned plan, reviewing development of plans around station areas, whether it be an existing station that's going to have more transit coming to it, higher capacity transit, those types of things, or a place that you're going to have future transit coming to. So conducting station area planning is an important strategy to ensuring you have that compact mixed use development near transit. Strategically managing parking in transit-oriented places. Parking is a land use, and so again, this is something where a local jurisdiction has a tremendous amount of influence. So how you treat parking in your policies and your plans is really important. We have a couple of strategies identified here. One of which is, you know, many jurisdictions have minimum parking requirements. So being able to reduce or in some cases eliminate parking requirements and maybe allowing the market to be able to address parking needs in those areas would be something that you would be able to look at in terms of your comprehensive plans. What kind of transit service are you looking at in the future, and being able to kind of make sure that parking is part of that equation, but is not like an overwhelming component in those transit oriented areas. And then how do you support the reduction in parking requirements? It's not just a kind of a changing the policies, but including incentives such as transit pass subsidies and other transportation demand management or TDM measures are really important. Other things besides transit pass subsidies, you could include bicycle parking and encouraging people to use bicycling as a mode. You can develop programs for supporting some of the shared mobility devices that are out there and kind of supporting other kinds of mobility other than an automobile in that transit supportive area. So those are just some examples of some of the areas around coordinating land use and transit. I feel like we've talked about this quite a bit, so we only included a few of the strategies here. Moving on to supporting multimodal mobility. This is kind of the core of what we'll be hearing us talk about under transit and planning for transit. We really are encouraging you all to work closely with your transit agencies. And that's a part of why we have a transit agency going to be following me today to kind of share some examples and some experiences there. It really is important to coordinate with transit agencies. Transit agencies have a state requirement to develop a 6-year transit development plan, and that's one of the plans you can coordinate around. And yet all transit agencies in our region now have long-range plans. So being able to kind of work with identifying the appropriate person in your transit agency that provides service in your area, identify that person, establish relationships, coordinate with them, make sure that they know what your plans are for land use and infrastructure within your communities, and understand what their plans are for transit in their communities. You can then use that collaboration and conversation to identify existing and future transit markets, and then the transit priority corridors that need to serve those markets as well. I'll be talking about speed and reliability in a future slide, but this is really important in being able to kind of like continue that conversation with transit agencies, and then building upon that also within if you don't have a high capacity transit service provider in your area, talk to your local transit agencies. If you don't have very much of that or are not planning for that very much in the future, who are the human service transportation agencies in your community who are providing mobility to people, whether it be a person with disabilities, an older adult, youth? There's a lot of different groups out there and a lot of different organizations providing mobility. I think one of the questions mentioned employers, that's one of the other groups you can talk to. And then there's also organizations out there that are promoting mobility coalitions at countywide levels and things like that. So just be really broad in kind of looking at who is providing mobility in your community. Make sure you reach out and coordinate with them. And I say that if you aren't sure about that, one good resource we have in our regional transportation plan is a coordinated mobility plan that has an inventory of organizations providing mobility in communities throughout the four county region. I'd encourage anyone who's not sure to look at that, and there's an inventory of services and organizations that are involved in that within that plan document, and that's an appendix to our regional transportation plan. The third bullet here talks about transit-oriented development plans, programs, and strategies. So ensuring consistency with the plans that your local jurisdiction has and comparing that to TOD plans, programs, and strategies of the transit agencies. We have several examples of transit agencies in our region with those. Sound Transit's one that I can just mention offhand here. They do have a TOD program. And so making sure there's communication and collaboration on those TOD plans, programs, and strategies is also important. The second area here under supporting multimodal mobility, promoting and implementing programs that encourage alternatives to driving alone. And to say, kind of to use a shorthand for this, we're talking about transportation demand management or TDM. So again, kind of talking about collaborating and working across organizations and jurisdictions. I'll continue that when we talk about TDM implementers in our region. Those can be transit agencies, but they can also be local jurisdictions. And many of you have programs that are addressing large employers at peak periods, the commute trip reduction or CTR program. But in addition to that, there's also transportation management associations or TMAs. There are, again, those mobility coalitions, large employers that have programs, institutions like the University of Washington. So identifying the organizations within your community that have TDM programs that are trying to encourage mode shifts for whatever reason and planning for mode shifts in the future is really important to kind of work with them in developing your comprehensive plan and working towards addressing what's in the second bullet under this category, identifying TDM strategies in your comprehensive plan and including those in that plan. So again, there are some near-term things that we have an inventory in our RTP and within the transportation visualization tool about TDM programs as well as an existing basis. But think broadly and about who to collaborate with and who to work with in terms of developing TDM programs that encourage use of transit and use of walking and bicycling and other modes to get to and from destinations. The last category under supporting multimodal mobility is enhancing transit speed and reliability. And so it's really important when you're encouraging people to use transit that you make sure that that transit is reliable, that it can get to, transit trips are typically slower than a single occupant vehicle going from A to B, and yet keeping transit trip competitive, making it so that it is as fast as possible and as reliable as possible is something that's going to be really important to encouraging people to use transit in your communities, whether it be a regional growth center, a high capacity transit station area, or other places that are transit oriented within your community, or even connecting to those communities. So we have a variety of strategies identified here. And I think kind of just asking yourself questions about kind of how you work with transit agencies and how you collaborate on things. The top bullet I'll focus a little bit of attention on is developing a category in the jurisdiction street classification system for transit priority streets. So a transit operator has lots of different considerations to think about. They have, if they're operating on the streets, they're oftentimes buses. So they're a 40 to 60 foot coach. They need room to be able to maneuver, to be able to make turns. They have needs around curb space and ability to stop and let passengers out and load passengers onto their vehicles in a fast and efficient manner. So how are local jurisdictions using their policies and plans to kind of plan for the infrastructure that is needed for transit agencies? And so a part of that is needing to have that conversation, that collaboration, and then maybe identifying a transit priority street classification within your comprehensive plan or within your implementing regulations and rules out of that comprehensive plan. That'd be really helpful to being able to ensure that transit is able to meet the speed and reliability needs of people who are going to be using that. And we're going to have a lot more people doing that in the future. So a lot of the other strategies on this kind of follow on that same theme, being able to coordinate on local actions regarding planning, funding, designing, and operating transportation facilities that meet the needs of transit agencies, and then adopting street design standards that support transit. I think the last bullet kind of like identifies some of the infrastructure types that would kind of examples of what we're talking about here, whether it be a transit signal priority system. So that would might operate on a corridor and allow a transit to move faster than it would otherwise move on that corridor. And that might have needs that cross over jurisdictional boundaries. And so transit agencies will need to be coordinating with your jurisdiction as well as other nearby jurisdictions. Dedicated transit lanes would be one example of another type of infrastructure. Where in your system would you be looking at potential to dedicate transit lanes, either full-time or part-time in the day, whether it be a bus access and a local access transit lane. Those types of things are all considerations to be thinking about. And then bus stop curb extensions are oftentimes an example of a type of infrastructure that allows transit agencies to shorten their dwell time when they have to stop at as a stop, and being able to load passengers and let passengers get off the bus and make that as efficient as possible. That's kind of the opposite of a bus pullout, where a bus might be trapped into an area, at least temporarily, while there's congestion around. Bus stop curb extensions allow them to load and unload passengers in a fast and efficient manner. And then not on this list, but also very important, is bus layover or other kind of transit vehicle layover facilities. And where does that fit into your comprehensive plan? I think those are the kinds of things that are often not thought about when we're talking about the transportation element of a local jurisdiction, but those are very important for transit agencies. And in my work with transit agencies, I've heard needs for that in very urban environments, as well as less urban areas as well. So being able to kind of work with your transit agencies and identify that to the best of your ability is really important. And then going beyond that, we can also talk about other types of modes and services. And I can ADA paratransit, curbs, curb space, and loading and unloading areas and things like that. So thinking about all modes and all types of transit in your community, and how you can ensure that they're as fast and reliable as possible, is really important. The next few slides, we're going to be getting into connecting people with transit, otherwise known as access to transit. And so this slide is going to go through a few of the different types here, where these are outlined also, I should just mention, in our regional transportation plan, as well as some of the access to transit resources I'll be mentioning shortly. But this, we start off here on the left-hand side from transit-oriented development, where we locate development in an area that transit either exists or is being planned for. And that's compact mixed-use development occurring there. Walking and rolling, whether it be using a wheelchair or a bicycle. We have transit to transit connections, and that includes everything from, we're talking rail, different types of rail modes, ferries, buses of various types, and vans. And then on the right-hand side here, we have different kinds of other modes. We're looking at drop-off and pickup, ADA paratransit, taxis and transportation network companies, as well as parking needs that are in existence, whether it be a park and ride or other kinds of parking. And then there's also connections to other modes, like here we have an example of airport, but there might be other kinds of modal connections as well. So it's important to be able to connect people no matter the different mode, thinking about it very in multimodal aspect of connecting people to transit. And I guess, and before leaving this, I also want to just mention, again, kind of thinking about the needs of the most vulnerable populations in your community when you're talking about access. So even when we're talking about the left-hand side here, people walking and accessing transit, think not just about an able-bodied person, like a working age person who's able to maybe make it across a street in a relatively short time. Think about older adults, youth, again, people with disabilities who might need a little bit more time to cross the street. Think about the needs of people, again, kind of on the right-hand side, those that are accessing transit, that are using an ADA paratransit, which is provided by transit agencies, one of the mobility on demand types of services. I think Thomas will talk about some of the ones community transit's exploring, but also think about those community shuttles, those senior service shuttles, volunteer transportation services, which seem a little bit more informal, but still have very important mobility services within a community. This slide just kind of illustrates some of the work we've done over the last few years. What I've been talking about so far have been kind of organized in the Transit Supportive Planning Toolkit that we'd done several years ago. More recently, we did produce these documents on a transit access checklist and toolkit. And we have a link to the resources there. I encourage you, even though there might be it's been a few years since some of this work has been done, it's all very relevant to today. And there might be, again, like a few changes or updates needed, but this is very relevant to your work today. So some of the main findings from the checklist and toolkit that I'll go over in the next few slides here. Context matters for improving access to transit. So again, we want to just make sure that we're covering not just context in terms of where you are in your jurisdiction. You might have a center downtown area, like a regional growth center or a high capacity transit station area, but there's also a neighborhood surrounding it, employment areas, manufacturing industrial centers or other kind of industrial areas, rural areas. What is the context of the land use? But also, where's the context within the transit system? Is it in a central area where there is lots of transit modes coming together and a lot of transfer activity? Is it an area at the edge of the transit system that maybe relies more upon a park and ride and maybe some kind of rural connecting services or things like that? The transit access checklist does do a really good job of talking about context. And here is an example on the right-hand side about that transit access checklist and some of the questions that are asked around urban form and built environment, which I think is very relevant to those of you that are working on your comprehensive plan updates. A second finding from the toolkit and checklist includes roles aren't always clear for delivering access improvements. And again, this is very kind of a relevant note here. We've been talking about connecting and coordinating with transit agencies. So there's the local jurisdictions and their responsibilities around rights of way and streets, sidewalks, and things like that. There are the local transit agencies and regional transit agencies with station areas and stops, needs for layover facilities and other kinds of things like that. And then there's the state and roles that state has with state routes and facilities such as park and rides that they might own and things like that. The Transit Access Toolkit does encompass that and talks about the different types of roles and traditional roles that are out there. You can see there's a Venn diagram on this illustration here about improving non-motorized environment, and it kind of shows an example. This Venn diagram shows areas that are kind of typically in one area or another. It might be more of a transit responsibility or more of a local jurisdiction responsibility, maybe more of a state responsibility, and then areas where those tend to overlap. We want to make sure that the different organizations are talking to each other and making sure that those things aren't actually gaps, that they're actually things that you're talking to each other about and addressing in all of your plans and coordination to make sure that we have really good seamless connections from biking, walking, transit, other connections to those different transit modes and transit hubs. My last slide here before turning it over to Thomas, just want to talk a little bit about what's next for access to transit. As I alluded to, we've done some work over the last few years, and I think we're anticipating more work to come. Access to transit was a main theme of our regional transportation plan that was recently adopted by our General Assembly. And so this slide shows some of the kind of what our RTP is calling for in terms of next steps for access to transit. Really continuing to up our game on equity and safety. So our goal around transportation is to kind of make it a very equitable and safe transportation system. So centering equity and safety in your transit access work is really important. And just kind of highlighting some of the other groups, the more vulnerable populations we've talked about and populations we need to think about, youth, older adults, people with disability, people with limited English proficiency who may have difficulty navigating your transit system if English isn't their first language. Think about those populations as you're thinking about equity and kind of centering equity in your work with transit agencies on transit. We know reinforcing location and context in access to transit. Our work to date has done a lot on that and advancing that concept. What more can we do there? How can we kind of really make sure that we're customizing our work on access to transit and connecting people to transit to address the context in the ways that I've mentioned earlier? The importance of land use decisions and affordable housing and improving access to transit. I think we've said a lot about land use and the framework and the setting that land use can do for transit and building transit markets, but we want to make sure that people, affordable housing is located near transit hubs and transit stops to make sure that the people who people of low income can access transit. And then improving access to transit is a shared responsibility. It's not just a transit responsibility. It's not just a local agency, local city or county responsibility. It's a shared responsibility among different entities. So kind of we envision doing more work around that as well. And so I think with that, I'm gonna transition things over to Thomas Tumala, manager of planning for community transit, to kind of give us some examples of a transit agency working with locals and kind of planning ahead for transit service from a transit agency's perspective. So with that, Thomas, do you want to take it away from here?
Thank you, Gil. I'm going to start off first slide here of content. Next slide, thank you. Transit agencies have a lot of different ways they see the world, and kind of ours is probably very similar to most other agencies probably in the state. We have a kind of working up from the bottom to the top, we have an annual budget, which kind of sets the whole detailed framework on how we're going to provide service with a kind of a balance of sources and uses. It's just a 1 year look ahead. It's kind of what you would see, you know, in our current schedules and the services that we put out there. It's not as relevant for kind of the work that this audience is going to do this year and next year, but it kind of sets the foundation for kind of everything that is builds on top of that. In the state of Washington, we have the transit development plan process that's updated every year. And that informs the budget process, also informs the long range planning process as well. It is basically a short range transit plan. It's a current year plus a total of 6 year look ahead of how we're gonna change our services, our operating budget and our major capital investments. And for most transit agencies, you know, vehicles and things like that are probably the biggest piece. Last and certainly not least is our long range plan. So just looking across the region right now, they're very much not in cycle with the current comp plan update. They range from, you know, 2030 or 2040 horizon year up to 2050. I think us, Community Transit and Kitsap Transit, are updating our long range plans, while many other agencies from the ferries, King County Metro, Sound Transit, name a few, have put a lot of effort into these and have done pretty big, very visible efforts probably 3-5 years ago. My message to you is, like, this would probably be the primary document to sort of ask about and kind of dig into for how our services might, you know, grow over this 20 plus year time frame. Next slide. So rapid changes. So if you were doing comp planning in the current time frame versus like 4 or 5 years ago, there's a lot that's changed, and a lot is continuously going to change over the 20 year time frame. So even though it might not impact your community or jurisdiction directly, but sort of in central Puget Sound, you know, Sound Transit light rail expansion is building out a pretty big network as we speak, with future plans, you know, beyond that to places like Tacoma and Everett. That's important, not just because it would, you know, put in new infrastructure and stations, but also allows local transit agencies to restructure their service around light rail, and also offload a lot of the very labor and resource intensive regional services to Link and provide enhancement of services, you know, in the local communities. Another big, you know, growth area, you know, for transit agencies throughout North America and the world is bus rapid transit expansion. And that's, you know, providing, you know, dedicated, very frequent bus route with, you know, basically show and go type of service, very frequent service throughout the day, typically better than a bus every 12 minutes. There's some dedicated infrastructure, there's transit signal priority, there's dedicated lanes. There's quite a few examples now in this area of this service, with expansion of more lines or routes over the next 20 years. And at the bottom of this slide, there's something called micro transit or on-demand transit. That's really a key topic in public transportation. There's actually quite a few pilot or initial corridors up and running in this region, with a lot more plans in the near future. I'd say kind of contrast it with high capacity transit. It's probably the most flexible, but not something that could have a lot of permanence, or it could have a lot of variability. It's a wide variety of things, everything from something more similar to a TNC, like an Uber or Lyft, to a formal community circulator. Capacity is somewhat limited because they can use much smaller vehicles, like the sedan example in the slide, to something like a cutaway. For those customers, you know, the experience is really controlled not to lines and stops, but zones, and more door-to-door oriented as a feeder to existing transit lines or as sort of a standalone kind of intra-community transit option. It's a big focus of our current long-range plan update. So I would definitely pay very close attention to this area, especially as it's sort of kind of a newer cutting edge kind of mode of our industry. Before I go to the next slide, kind of two overall themes is definitely like ridership evolution and ridership changes and zero emission bus, that is like electric buses and hydrogen fuel cell buses. These were two very big topics at the American Public Transit Association meeting last week in Seattle. You know, as demand has changed coming out of the pandemic, there's definitely more of an emphasis on all day and all week travel demand, which has had a lot of resiliency through the pandemic, as well as zero emission bus. And, you know, the caution with that is it's really an evolving technology. So like facility needs and dynamics that you might see today could be very different even like 5 years or a couple years from today. But things like vehicle charging at the end of a bus route or a transit center can be very real estate intensive and also very utility intensive. And so if you're planning a lot of redevelopment around that, that's something definitely to pay close attention to. So next slide. So I want to kind of, without getting into a lot of details, kind of think about how you interface with transit agencies, the questions you might have and kind of the explorations you might need to undertake through the long range plan. A lot of these long range plans have kind of, you know, kind of three key deliverables at the end of those processes. One is, you know, a financial model, looking at the long-term financial outlook of providing all the service and the sources and uses needed in a financially unconstrained way to deliver that vision. Service standards and guidelines, that's extremely relevant. That has to do with, you know, levels of service, customer access, complete streets, transit emphasis corridors, and how that might change over time. So in the map there that you see, that's from our last, our current long range plan. And it's showing, you know, where there would be different corridors of existing and future transit throughout here is in Snohomish County, and how that might change over time, and that sort of a typology kind of associated with that. And next point number two, what types of land uses support different service levels or modes? So everyone wants high capacity transit probably at their front door, but that's not always possible. So we really kind of tie, you know, transit investment to land use and kind of what kind of demand is going to be out there to support that. So the bar is much higher from a land use and travel demand standpoint for something like bus rapid transit than it would be for something that's say on demand or like an hourly fixed route bus service. So just kind of keep that in mind. That usually drives, you know, agencies' guidelines or service standards. There has to be that land use transportation link. Next point. And infrastructure compatibility, and that comes in all different flavors. It could, you know, be from sort of a major like the, you know, transit center or terminal facility, which might need a lot more real estate, not just for stops, but for layover and some of these evolving needs like zero emission charging infrastructure and signalization. It could need transit signal priority or along major arterial corridors. And it could mean some stuff that's sort of maybe overlooked and a little bit more mundane. But, you know, if you look at a lot of the transactions or, you know, conversations we have with jurisdictions, there's a lot of action around stops and, you know, street, you know, widenings or renovations or retrofits. So if you go to the next slide, it's my last slide, this is kind of a good TED Talk moment here. This is a picture of a roundabout, a brand new one that just came into existence this fall in the city of Arlington. It's situated right kind of in the middle of the Cascade Industrial Manufacturing Center, which is far north end of Snohomish County, where a lot of, you know, kind of tech, manufacturing, logistical kind of businesses are kind of going in. And you can kind of see on the two quadrants to the left, there's some existing kind of office park, kind of light industrial or commercial kind of development, large setbacks from the street, but in the context of a comp plant, that might change over time. And if you look to the southeast quadrant, there's a big Amazon facility that's gone in, actually paid for a considerable amount of the construction of a lot of the street improvements in that area, including the roundabout. But there's a lot of considerations about just not how kind of new streets kind of set the framework for future bus transit, how the customers, how the people with various needs might access the service or need to access the service. And then there's my favorite topic is if you're going to bring transit service in there, things like where you would put stops, but maneuverability of the vehicle themselves. So I think there's an old saying, if you've seen one roundabout, you've seen run roundabout. And thinking about kind of looking beyond what a plan might say and what a ruler might say or what auto turns might say, but how actually, you know, working with your transit operators on how they would not just access streets and future stops, but how they actually might be able to get through these newly developed areas, including some of the infrastructure safely and reliably. So with that, I will hand it back to Gil.
Thank you. And I think I'm going to turn it back over to Kelly to kind of go over some Q&A, I think, while Thomas and I might be on the hot seat, or maybe more so me.
All right. Terrific. Well, thanks to you both. We had an earlier question. So, Gil, you touched on transportation demand management as one of the, access to transit and planning for transit. And the question is, and I know we've done some inventory work to kind of gauge what all the TDM types of programs that are out there. But do we have a document, and maybe this is an RTP question, that identifies how TDM has been incorporated in various comp plans around the region?
I don't think we have a specific document ourselves, but that is something that's come out of the RTP that was called upon to do some work around integrating TDM policies and plans into comprehensive plans, making sure that they're consistent, making sure that they also kind of have implementing regulations and rules that make sure that they are effective. And so I think that is work we've done with our TDM advisory committee and others. And I think our presentation there just was trying to weave that in. It's not just that you build transit or provide the service, but make sure that there's programs in place to educate people about how to use it, provide incentives and other things to make sure that those mode shifts are occurring.
Terrific. And this might be a question either for you or for Thomas, and it has to do with planning around school population growth and the kind of connection between are there methods or is there guidance around, I think the question is getting at planning for transit, considering school location and school, just growth in school populations. And I don't know if that's something that we necessarily touch on, but I'm wondering if either of you have an answer to that or even a reference point where we could direct folks to other resources that might be available on that.
Maybe I could start off and Thomas can join it, but I think that I would just reflect that schools are a land use right, and that is kind of again where local jurisdictions are planning for their long term. They have facilities, elements to try to plan ahead for school districts or another entity that are not part of necessarily of a local jurisdiction, but that planning for those land uses and having those land uses in a place that is makes it really easy for youth to use transit, right? For if you're planning a new school or planning for expansion, to make sure that those are and that there's programs in place to connect youth to transit or other kinds of services. I want to just kind of expand it to kind of what I said in my presentation. It's not just the transit agencies that Thomas kind of represents, but other organizations that are available to get youth to their schools and other places. And maybe I'll just turn it over to Thomas about kind of adding to that or your own perspectives.
I think many transit agencies, including community transit, we have kind of layers of data because we look at it sort of historically and currently. We have like a essential services or essential facilities, and they even end up as landmarks on our transit maps and our schedule. It's very prominent. But I think what's changed, and you know, this is sort of the new paradigm with the free youth transit passes that are now in effect since early this fall throughout Washington state. That's anyone under 19, that's pretty much K through 12 rides transit for three. We actually have a lot more capability from a data standpoint, as well as ridership, to sort of better guide this planning going forward. I think that data is just beginning to trickle in, but I think there's a much larger focus on that than before because of just the nature of how the ridership market has changed. And that's going to be in effect for the next 16 years. So it's a short and a long-term phenomenon.
Terrific. Thanks to you both. Going back to kind of addressing the disparity maps and the equity conversation, I'm not sure, Jennifer or Gil, if either of you mentioned the PSRC visualization tool that was included in the regional transportation plan, but kind of building from that, as well as the community portal that Kyle displayed. The question is about, you know, how can folks use that information as it relates to transportation planning? So Gil, since you're the one with the camera on, maybe you can talk a little bit about some of the data that's included in our visualization tool that's related to the community portal, and just how folks can use all of that information to kind of identify the gaps and opportunities as we outlined in the RTP.
I think there are some demographic data, and I can't quite remember exactly how we characterize it, but there is demographic data about people with low incomes, different kinds of demographic groups that I mentioned several of them. I think probably older adults and people with disabilities and others, that you can kind of look at that visualization tool, and you can see where they live, places that they're located. I think we have similar kinds of maps and things like that in our coordinated mobility plan as we plan for people who have challenges with transportation and vulnerable transportation needs. So, but that is our visualization tool, and I think you could then use that as like overlaying where our existing transit routes, where our future transit routes, as an example, are those populations going to be receiving better transit service over time? How are we planning for accessing that? That's the kind of thing I think that would be relevant for local jurisdictions. And again, those are kind of transit connections, but also there's facility data for sidewalks and other kinds of things that you can identify. Are there actually sidewalks connecting youth or places where people, youth to schools, as we're just kind of connecting to the last question. So is there anything else you want to bring up?
No, I would just elaborate a little bit, you know, similar to, so the, whether it's the environmental disparity maps, the equity focus areas that Gil was alluding to that's in the PSRC data, the opportunity mapping information, all of that's in our RTP. We spend a lot of time talking about equity, but I think the plug for the visualization tool is, as Gil just mentioned, there's also, what's on the ground today in terms of facilities. So local jurisdictions can look to see, you know, are there sidewalks connecting to transit within these overlay areas that we're talking about. We have that both for the existing conditions as well as forecast conditions. So that would be kind of my short answer on that one. Mm-hmm. And then maybe I think one more question that we have, and this might be both either for Gil or for Liz, and it really has to do with the design of transit areas and transit stations, and the commenter is talking about what they're referring to as the vendorscape in terms of amenities that might be around each transit station, including micro mobility. And the question is, do we have guidance that either that addresses design standards or other types of information related to the design of the transit areas?
I think that's kind of like that. That's kind of, if I'm understanding the question correctly, it's kind of like the issue of allowing curb space for a variety of different types of mobility uses, space on the public right of way for things like shared mobility devices, whether it be a scooter or a shared bicycle or whatever, and kind of how that all works together, and ensuring a lot of different multiple modes come together. I don't think we have any detailed design guidance, but I know that's something the transit agencies are very interested in. Again, I think working with and collaborating with transit agencies, and maybe there is some need out of kind of some potential work that, you know, whether we just are bringing together folks for conversations on that. But I think that in the absence of that, I think I would just kind of like reach out to the transit agencies and work with them on the specifics on that.
Yeah, I think that's a great response. I would put a plug. We do have a short guide on TOD that we just published on our site, and it doesn't get into sort of this level of detail exactly, but it does point to other existing resources about sort of TOD, and including a few resources on design. So it doesn't quite get to this level of detail, but there's certainly probably things out there that are available.
And I guess my last thing is that is the shared responsibility I was talking about in my talk. It's not just a transit responsibility or a local jurisdiction. There's multiple entities involved. So just getting them all together at the table to talk about that.
All right. Well, that was perfect timing. Liz, that was the end of our questions, and I'll turn it back over to you.
Great. Thank you. So I have one final slide that I will pull up for us. Great. Well, we really appreciate all of you attending today. It's been a really nice session. So if you have additional questions, please feel free to reach out. I know that our individual contact information was provided on the last slide, but just about our plan review resources in general, please feel free to reach out at planreview@psrc.org. We have one final poll question. Michaela, if you could pull that one up. Great. So the question is, how are you feeling after the workshop? So we'd love to kind of get a sense of where we're at as a group following the workshop today. And if you have any additional feedback, so we, as you saw early on, are doing a lot of these sessions over the next few months. So we're definitely happy to take any suggestions you might have either in the box here, or if you want to email us later, that's okay too. But really appreciate everyone attending here today. There were a number of questions about whether we would be providing resources. We will provide a follow-up email to attendees or people who registered for this. That includes links to the things people brought up, as well as our presentations, as well as the recording. So look for that in your inbox in the next few days. And we hope people will be able to attend a future event. So I might give us just one more moment to fill out the poll questions. Once the webinar ends, our Title VI poll will launch. That is optional, but we appreciate your help in addressing our Title VI responsibilities. Okay, it looks like we're kind of getting there in terms of responses to this question. So I might end our poll and end our webinar and thank everyone for participating, including our presenters. Hope you have a great day.